I'm going to create a new document here. Yeah, if ever I think it was somebody asked me, if it doesn't say exactly what size document to use, what's a good size document to use, then I would say just go ahead and go with the with a 8.5 by 11. And if I haven't specified whether you go horizontal or vertical with your orientation, like here, is up to you. I like the horizontal. I make a lot of arguments for horizontal because I always use this analogy, like what size is your screen, your TV? It's wide. What type is your computer screen? It's wide. The only thing that is square nowadays is your phone. Used to be old TV was 4 by 3. It was almost square. Now the only square thing is your phone. So I always compose things as if they're going on TV or cable television or something like that. They can be presented in a video. So I'm going to make that wide and go ahead and open this. Now, I'm
Even
not
your
sure. I'm going to
tablet,
open these. Go ahead.
even your tablet is a is like a portrait square too.
Well, oh gosh, yes, absolutely. And thanks for sort of telling me that. Well, when you look at an 8.5, your what they call the artboard, which is the page size, that is can really be anything. And a lot of the time, well, a lot of the time I choose something like 8.5 by 11. It's not even about what the document is going to end up being. So yes, if you're working on a tablet, then portrait is perfectly fine. So I'm just kind of giving you the rationale for why I'm choosing what I am now. Oh, I forgot to sort of say that one of the reasons why I showed you. The image I showed you was to talk about masking, which is the first thing I was gonna talk about today. Let me open it up here. Yes, I know the font is dead. There you go. All right. So when I look at this, let me make sure that I am correct. Yes. Okay. So here you can see that there's parts in my illustration that are going outside of what you see. Like the tips of those of the sun is going outside the square. And that's because that image is masked. Anyway, I can't really work with this file except to say I may be able to unmask it here. Let me see if I can do clipping mask release. So that's under the object pull down menu, object, clipping mask, release. And when I release it, now you see, first of all, you see all those anchor points I warned you about. So moving any of that background is just a nightmare, for me to try and click on that. I'm going to deselect here. So when I click on this, let me hide that. This is the background, and I can sort of get that out of there and get back to the elements that I drew. I'm using Command 3 to hide the fonts, which are defaulting. I'm actually just gonna grab what's left of Miss Suzanne here and paste her into my new document. Whoops, sorry about the dress, Suzanne. Shoot, I have to open it again. Yeah, I lost her dress. Actually, it doesn't matter. I don't need that anyway to show you what I'm talking about. I'll just go ahead and paste it back in there. So a mask is any shape that goes in front of a shape or a group of shapes or 1,000 shapes or 1,000,000 shapes that crops it to its own size. So I'm going to use an oval here. I'm just going to get my polygon tool. I'm going to tear it off and pull out a little palette here so you guys can see what I'm doing. I know enough now to put the palettes on the left side of my screen so the faces aren't over top of it. I'm just going to grab my ellipse tool and I'm going to press and drag an oval and reposition it a little bit. over Miss Stokes here. Now, I have one shape on top of the other, and the hierarchy of shapes is important when you're masking because it's kind of going to go whatever's on top. Not only that, whatever's on top can be more complex than a single shape. Let me show as I go. So, in order to create the mask, I've got to select the topmost object and all the objects underneath that I wish to mask under that. So I have imported the images of from the cover. I'm going to select all of that and go under the object pull down menu and choose clipping mask, make, and that cuts it to that. Interesting fun fact and all. I can deselect my image. I just got the direct selection tool. And I'm going to hold down the option key and click on this mask. So I'm selecting just the mask and none of its parts. And now I can reposition the mask over top of the art. And this is one of those things I'm talking about with the selection tool versus the direct selection tool. So if I hit V for selection tool and clicked on it with the direct selection tool, even though you don't see all the sub parts being selected, if I move it, it's moving all of them. And that had to do with which of the two selection tools I had selected. So it's really important to understand that relationship between the black arrow tool or the selection tool and the white arrow tool or the direct selection tool. So I'm pretty sure that there's a way that I can show that I have that sub layer selected under view somewhere, but I'm not going to pursue that to show you because I'm not exactly sure where that is. Because right now, what I'm saying is, right now, I have way more selected than just this oval. You only see the oval selected because it's a mask. But if I unmask it right now, and I'm going to go under Object pull down command to clipping mask and choose release, I can see that I have many more other shapes which are now visible that weren't visible before. So masking can be a little tricky and it doesn't always sort of represent visually what you actually have. So be aware that it has a lot to do with which of the selection tools you have selected. So I'm going to hit Y on here. I do Command Y, or if you're on a PC, it would be Control Y. Hold down the Control and hit the letter Y, and this puts you into I think it's called Preview. No, this is Preview, and the other one is Outline. So I'm in Outline mode here. If you go under the View pull down menu, it's right up there at the top, the second command from the top. So when I'm in preview mode, I can see, in fact, what all my anchor points and vectors are. And if I get the direct selection tool here, the white arrow tool, and start clicking on these shapes, I can see these shapes and I can select them individually with the direct selection tool. And I can also reposition them. So if I want to give her some wild hair sticking out of the side of her head. This allows me to make changes, editorial changes, not only to the shape of the mask, but to the sub elements. I'm going to go ahead and delete that and then go back to my star tool and press and drag and give myself a couple more stars here and sort of reposition that using the space bar. Then I'm going to select all, and again, I'm going to go under Object and choose clipping mask make, and now I've clipped her to the shape of the star I made. So, there's like all kinds of fun that you can have with that. It really takes me up into the next thing I'm going to show you before we actually go into a little bit about typography and what typography is. So the first thing I'm going to do is undo that. And I'm going to make you, I'm going to make you the letter O, brought to you by your teacher. Let me get back to here, scoot over to the side here. So I'm going to hit my, make sure I don't have anything selected. And I do that by clicking out, you know, holding down the command key to get my whatever selection tool I had last, really emphasizing that, that what, no matter what tool you have selected, when you hold down the command or on the PC on the control key, when you hold that down, it changes your cursor from whatever type tool, scale tool, whatever you have selected, it's going to turn it into the last selection tool you had picked. For me, that's the direct selection tool. So I'm actually going to hit L for the ellipse tool. And that gives me the ellipse tool. If I press and drag, I have a lovely little ellipse here. I'm going to go over to my colors on the toolbar, and I'm just going to hit the default stroke and fill colors. And I'm actually going to swap them so that it's a white stroke with a black fill. And oh, that's lovely. And, you know, whoopee, tra-la-la, we go skipping through the forest. Now I'm going to make another circle over top of that. I'm just going to press and drag, and I'm going to reposition it a little bit there. And you can see where it is because it's got a white stroke and it's over there. And you know, I want to make sure these things are perfectly aligned. I don't think they are. So I'm going to select both of them, and I'm going to go under the window and pull down the align menu. Oh, the align menu. Where did I pull it out? Where'd it go? Hello, align. Oh, here it is. It's behind thus and such. Here we go. So here's the align menu. So if I have more than one object selected and I go to the align menu, I can choose a variety of ways in which to align my objects. I can align them by horizontal or vertical. This is horizontal, would be this way. I undo that. Vertical would be this way. Undo that. I just really wanted that. I had it in the right horizontal. I just want it to be vertically aligned this way. So I'm going to hit that, and that aligns them perfectly vertically. Now, I have them both selected, both the top object and the bottom object. So I'm going to go under my object pull down menu and choose compound path, make. And when I do that, or I could hit Command 8, lo and behold, not only does the interior of the letter O become white, like the background, but if you move it over an object, you can see it's not just white, it's transparent. So you can see through it and do not have to change or update any of that information. You don't have to compensate for that being opaque. So this is the basics of sort of what a compound path and what a mask is. So a mask keeps everything outside of a predefined shape from showing, where a compound path takes two overlapping shapes and makes where they overlap transparent. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, I'm going to move my letter O out of the way for just a brief moment here. Hit spacebar to reposition my page. And this time I'm going to take the rectangle tool with rounded corners, give myself a nice rounded corner there and pull that out. And then I'm going to pull two more inner ones out. Let's see if I can do this. Okay, that's three shapes. One, a background shape, and one, three, four, a overlapping shapes. So if I select all those overlapping shapes and go under the object menu to compound path make, again, it's knocked both of those shapes out from the background. If I place it over a more complex shape, I can see through it just like you would any type. But if you notice, if I preview it, it is a shape, it is not type. Because when I preview type, it appears black. And this is one of the main things we've got to get on to here in just a second. Now, I do want to point out something. I'm going to get my direct selection tool. And if I click on a segment with the option alt key down, I can select the whole inner circle without selecting all the other ones. And I'm going to hold down the shift key to add to a selection. And I'm going to click on the lower one. Now I've selected the two internal shapes, but not the external borders. If I use my arrow keys to move them to the right, you'll see what goes on is that, in fact, when they go outside of their compounded shape, they become opaque and not translucent again. So this is if you're getting caught up in my terms, maybe that'll help. So as you move it, if the two shapes unaligned from each other, it goes back to being a positive. It's only the overlap of shapes that defines what becomes transparent. I have had many, 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 many shapes in a compound path. I don't know what kind of a limit to it there is. I have not recently run across any limit, but let me just test my theory here by making several more shapes than normal. And I'm even going to double overlap some of those shapes to see what happens. And we'll double overlap those two. Now I'm going to select that whole mess right there and go under object and choose compound path make. And just as I predicted, internally, the overlapping shapes create transparency. And when they double overlap, it's one or the other. It's either 100% opaque or translucent. So when I move these over our subject here, you can see that that's true. So it's a really useful thing. You know, like if I say wanted to take this portrait of Suzanne and create a frame around it, well, I'm going to press and drag this rectangle. And then I'm going to hit Command C for copy and Command F for paste in front. I'm going to hit S on my keyboard for the scale tool. And I'm going to press and drag to create two overlapping shapes. If I select them both, I can then choose Object, Compound Path, Make. Am I talking in a monotone? Then you can take the two shapes and choose object compound path. So this tariff was called anyone? Anyone? Bueller? I know half the time you don't know what I'm talking about, but it's okay. Thanks for laughing, Joe. Thanks.
You're talking about the squares, right?
No, he's talking about Ferris Bueller.
Yeah, I mean, I
That's
like
what you're talking
Ferris
about.
Bueller to me is just, you know. It's a rite of passage. It's true for all generations, I think. My favorite quote, okay, now you got me off, but my favorite quote from Sloane Peterson, don't worry about it. Sooner or later, everybody visits the zoo, which I think is like, thank you, Sloane Peterson. I'll remember that for the rest of my life. She had no idea when she was making that movie that people would walk around and think about what she said. Yeah, you're right. It's a miracle what a Fitzky will do. Anyway, enough Ferris Bueller references. So here I am making it a frame. So I think I've driven home a lot about what you can do with a mask and a compound path. I would say that masking is frequently useful in a larger sense when you, I'm sorry, when you want to sort of complete something that maybe has edges that are over the side and you don't want it to look sloppy. You want it to look nice and neat. You know, you can either go back in and cut object odd ends off, Or you can, I usually don't do that because I may wish to reposition it at some later time, like this sun in the background. I mean, I never did. This was, set up to be the way it was. Because I had used a mask, that's sort of similar to what we talked about in Photoshop about non-destructive editing. Rather than cutting those edges off, I just masked them off. And that meant that if I wished to copy them and use them in another illustration, like I just did now, they would still be fully intact. Okay. So here's a new document. How do I say to do it? Let me look real quick. Me just make sure I do it the way I say it here. Okay. So the first thing I'm going to do is take the pen tool and make the opening of the eye. So here's the opening of my eye. I'm hitting the corners there to make it a corner point up here. I'm actually going to pull this one back a little bit. There we go. Okay, so this is the outside of my eye. I'm going to get the ellipse tool and hit Option Alt to draw from the center out and draw that part of the eye. I'm going to press and drag from the center again and make the pupil. And I'm going to press and drag up here to make the just a highlight. So the highlight, I'm going to take the stroke off. And the pupil, I'm going to drag the stroke color onto the fill. And then on the outside one, I'm going to hit a gradient, make it radial. Oops, I'm on the stroke. Undo, undo, and go here and hit the gradient and create a, double click here. Come on, baby. Oh, please stop. Give me the. There we go. I'm going to change the color model from black, the default, to CMYK, and I'm going to make this person's eyes brown. I'm going to pick a nice dark brown color for the first stop. Double click on the second stop, change it to CMYK, and change that to a lighter brown. Somewhere in here. Where's light brown? There we go. And I'm going to change that to radial gradient. So well, there you go, radial gradient. I'm going to make the halfway point closer to the dark edge, just to make it a little lighter on the center. And if I want, I might select all three of these objects and go under Object and choose Group. Now, the other thing I think I did on my outer side is is point out that nobody's eye is really white. And actually, what I'm going to do is put just a smidge of pink on this corner and double click here. This is a smidge of pink already. Make this a bit lighter. And then in the center one is going to be almost white. So pull this way back. Now I have two halfway points at this point, so I'm going to push both of those halfway points back so that it looks pretty much like the center is white. I'm even going to take more out of there. And thus and such, there we go. Now, let me just check over there, make sure what else I got. Nope, I'm doing okay. Now, the white part of the eye, I made a gradient. And I'm going to leave it in the back because I want the white part of the eye to remain having some color in it. But I am going to select it and I'm going to copy it. And I'm copying it and pasting it in front, all the way in front. Because it's going to be the actual mask. Whatever's in the very front is going to be the mask. So I'm going to select all of that and choose Object, Compound Path, Make, and what did it do? Let me make, wow, something went wrong here. I'm going to cut that and paste it again. Make sure it's not grouped or something. Let me see. That should make a compound path. Oh, I'm no, I'm saying clip. I meant to say clipping mask, not compound path. There we go. Sorry, I really know. Now the way I did this is really great for an animator because if I get the direct selection tool now and go back over here and go in and select. These subparts, I think I should be able to move them. No, it's not going to let me move them. The mask is, let me see if I can lock the mask. Yeah. Yeah, I would have to unmask it, but the point I guess I'm making is that if I go ahead and unmask it and then select the eye and change it. I can radically change the emotion of the eye. So now I've taken the eye from the sleepy eye to the scared eye, you know, that yeah, looking, you know, when the eye is in the lower part, you're either looking down or your eyes are wide open and you're fearful. So, you know, we can get a lot of emotion out of the positioning of the eye. Like if the pupil is very far up underneath the eye, when we mask it, it looks you know like that person is very sleepy, or you name what it is they are when their eyes look like that. There you go. So because it's you know I've got it grouped a certain way, I can sit here and reposition it and then you know, remask it to get all these various motions of the eye in there. So rather than redrawing the eye or trying to make the iris and the pupil with the pen tool, which is, you know, hard to do to make it met cut be cut off by the opening of the eye, this allows me to just go in there and have a perfect circle like your eye is. So I'm going to go ahead and hit on my stroke here. I don't think I can change the stroke. Let me see if I can. I've selected the stroke with the direct selection tool and let me go ahead and put the stroke on there. And then under the stroke weight, I'm going to increase that to whatever I need to make it look right. So, and also I can make it dark brown, which would probably in this case make more sense. Then I can create, you know, sort of shapes that go with that. Like, for instance, if I was to create a series of eyelash shapes, oops. So I'm going to send that to the back, oops, and swap colors. Send it to the back. Probably not black enough, I think. That, there you go. So anyway, this is one of the ways like you can employ a mask that's really useful. So I'm glad I got that in at the last minute. Sorry, I almost forgot that one. Any questions about that?
So you
No.
choose, so then you choose the clipping tool. Like when I go over into my, I go to compound path and I go to clipping mask and I go.
Yeah, sort of any shape you have, any two shapes you have. I've got this shape here. I can create a clipping path out of any single overlapping shape.
So in order to go to clipping path, you go to clipping mask. In the
No, you
object
go no no
tab.
no you no you go to object to clip to clipping mask make.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay, so what's the question about it?
I go to the object tab on my menu bar, then I go down to clipping mask as I see it, and I go to make.
Yeah. So whatever the top object you have selected, Gabriella, is going to be the one that clips the other shape or shapes. Like for instance, right here, I have this top shape selected, and it is the clipping path for the other rectangle. So if I change it, it's going to change the clip. So you are correct. Under the object pull out command down there by clipping mask.
And then when we do this, digital exercise, do we have to put that extra thing around the eye? Like the brown part?
You mean like the radial gradient like I did?
Well, actually, the stuff outside of the eye, which is the brown part.
Like the lash. This one right here that I put on. No, just like what the assignment shows you will be fine. If you want to do extra, that's fine too. I encourage all the creativity you want to put into it. But I'm just really looking to, it's like going to be a pass fail. You got the mask to work. You didn't get the mask to work. So it'll be like a pass fail thing. But definitely have fun with it. You know, do both eyes, make both eyes, or, you know, even put them on a face if you want to. You know, I encourage all the creative idea that you might have with it. But all I'm really going to give you a grade on is whether or not you made a mask work. Simple assignment.